268. Rise up, O men of God. Said or done that would glorify your name. I thank you for everyone who has come today.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, George.
Good morning.
Okay.
These boys, hey, I'm gonna be safe. These boys are so nervous.
I didn't know where you put it.
George, do it.
And I had to tell you to go get it. We'd like to welcome each and every one of y'all to Ridgeview Baptist Church this morning. And our announcements will be on January 31st. We still have Bible study and youth meeting on Wednesday night. We need everyone to come out and to participate in it. And February the 11th, we have Valentine's Fellowship, a spaghetti and salad, and food and fun. And on February 15th, Ladies Prayer Group, and it's church, and the Men's Fellowship go to Cheddar's. Anybody need to say anything?
We have a sign-up sheet for the Valentine's Fellowship.
There's a sign-up sheet for the Valentine's Day out in the vestibule.
You need to come to the Valentine's Day or the Valentine's dinner if you can. There's going to be some special things happen, so I would like many to come as can. It's going to be a fun time. Take your hymn books again and turn to number 393. 393, Own a Christian Soul. Exactly.
Amen.
Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Well, I don't know how this is going to go. We're going to do it anyway.
Rick, you don't know where to sing, don't you?
Huh?
You don't know where to sing, don't you?
War cease, the whole world lives in peace. Bitterness and hatred fade away. Foes talk, the whole world walks the walk. That's what happens when men pray. Healing starts, God mends all broken hearts. Nobody goes to bed afraid. Blind are led, the hungry all are fed. That's what happens when men pray. When men pray. Father's will is done, the whole world can be one. That's what happens when men pray.
Tears flow, chains fall from burdened souls. Families gather in God's name. Kids laugh, moms see no violent wrath. That's what happens when God prays. When men pray, when men pray, the heart of God is touched. When men pray, as the Father's will is done, the whole world can be one. That's what happens when men pray. When
That turned out better than I thought it would.
Yeah, it did.
I thank God for, first of all, for loving me enough to send his son to die on the cross for me.
Amen.
Most of all, for sending his son to die on the cross for
me. Amen.
My second song is by the Inspirations. I can't sing it like the Inspirations. I wouldn't try. But it's got a wonderful meaning to it. Don't you listen to the words I say? I've been on my way to heaven.
Guess it's my turn. Morning.
Morning.
I want to thank you in advance for praying for the men, because we definitely need it. I think George was nervous. Amen. Well, you know, last Sunday, Scott come up to me and he said, Doyle, you've been nominated to preach next Sunday.
I don't think so.
And I said, well, awesome. I said, who nominated me? Sam. So if y'all don't like the sermon, it's Sam's fault. I'm just giving you some advanced knowledge. But I couldn't help to think, while I was on the way home, I was saying, Lord, what you want me to preach? So I couldn't help, as I passed churches after churches, and a lot of them were empty. And I said, Lord, what draws people to church? What makes people want to go to church? So that's what my sermon is based on, is what do you look for in a church? Or how strong is the first title. Or how big is it? Or maybe how rich is it? That's today's society in a whole. You know, what do you think caused the churches to go empty. Well, I'm going to give you one of the biggest examples you could, and you might hear it, you're going to hear it a couple times. A couple years ago, COVID-19. That gave thousands upon thousands of people the excuse they were looking for to get out of church. Now, I took the liberty of trying to look up what the biggest church in the world was. You know, I'm not going to name them. But one church I looked up had 15,000 members. Big church. And I said, wow, that's huge. But there was another one I looked up, and I ain't going to say it. Y'all know it. It had 45,000 members. Big church. And then I looked up one. It had 1,134,000. That's a big church, ain't it? But did you know that is not the biggest church in the world? It's not. Who thinks they know what the biggest church in the world is? Well, I'm going to give you an example, and it's going to be comical, but it's true. It is the biggest church in the world today. Oh, hold on a minute. I got a phone call. Hello? Why, yes, ma'am. Well, yes, you can become a member of Ridgeview Baptist Church. Yeah, we'll send you all the information. Thank you, ma'am. Be blessed. What's the biggest church in the world today? The television. Do you know how many thousands of people just watching on TV? Now, let me get it straight. Everything I talk about today in this sermon, you cannot get it on television. You cannot get it. And the reason why I say that is every Sunday, the pastor gets up here. You cannot see what he sees. All you can see is him. And today, all you can see is me. Amen? You cannot see it. And yet thousands upon thousands of people choose to watch the television. Now, don't get me wrong. They are people that cannot come to church. Health reasons, whatever it may be. Whatever it may be. But God knows those people. And then the other 99%, he knows that too. Amen? But let me ask you a question. How strong is your church? Well, the pastor can tell you how strong it is because he sees what I see today. Amen? Now, I don't know if it bothers the pastor or not, but let me give you an example. And I'm going to give some examples because it's evidence. You know, one of the greatest ways to tell if your church is strong enough is when the pastor gives a scripture, and I write it down at the top. And I know why I said that. He sees me. I don't know if it bothers him. But I write down the scripture. Amen? And then I do this. And last Sunday, he preached on 2 Samuel 14. God will burn your barley field. Now, why do we do that? Because the Word of God is for reproof. And I come to hear the Word of God. And how can I follow along with the man of God if I don't open the Word of God? You know? There are some things the pastor sees that make the church weak. Well, for instance, I'm sorry if I struck a nerve. Let me tell you another one. Amen? Well, I want to give you an example of another one that makes the church weak. It's not strong. Well, I'm going to move on this one. Let's just say I'm done, and I'm not. I still got an hour to go. We're done. And we give the benediction, which is the closing prayer, and we all shake hands. Y'all know that. We leave. Amen? What did I do wrong? Can somebody tell me? He wasn't watching, was he? Where did I leave it? Where did I leave it? How many times have I seen this left on the pew? You can use this as an example, but an excuse. Oh, I got four or five Bibles. And that's true, I do. I've got several open Bibles, several study Bibles. I even got a Red Testament outline Bible. But you know, you bring the one you read the most to church. Am I right? And if you leave it right there, what are you reading at home? Huh? So if we ask, how strong is your church? See, y'all can't see that on that television right there, how strong this church is. Only the pastor can. He can see who's opening the Word of God. And I know it might bother him, but a lot of times when he gives scripture, I read a couple above it and a couple below it. Why? Because sometimes I'm hard of understanding. So I want to have a great understanding of what he's reading. He looks down there and he might see me, you know, flipping over to the scripture. That's fine. But he's watching everybody. You ever notice that? He can see everyone. But if you choose to watch it on television, all you can do is see me. And if someone says, hey, did you go to church yesterday? I sure did. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. Let's go a little farther. I ain't got but about 100 here. 1 Timothy 4:12. Let's look at the testimony of the church. The testimony of the church in 1 Timothy 4:12. It says, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Do you see that in today's church? Can you see conduct? Can you see love? Conduct and love go hand in hand. Now, I'm just going to... I love using the examples because God allowed it to be here today. When you come into the house of God, like as you have today, normally you see two beautiful men back there giving out bulletins. Well, one anyway. Amen? Amen? And let me ask you something. How are they giving them out? How are they giving them out? You don't see that, do you? Normally, in 99, I don't know... I smile all the time. I love it. And I welcome you into the house of God. In love, in conduct. Is that not true? When you get a bulletin, that's the first thing you see. That sets the atmosphere in the rest of the part of Christ. In spirit. How many of y'all can sit at home and see the spirit? You can't. You cannot see the spirit sitting at home. How about the faith? Huh? You can't see it sitting at home. How much faith does this church have? Let me tell you something. I've been here a while, wouldn't you think? And I know what a lot of y'all's been through. So if someone asks me, how much faith does this church have? I can tell them the truth. It's got a lot of faith. A lot of faith. Now, how do I know that? Because I've seen what a lot of people's gone through. And let me tell you something. How do you feel the Spirit? Well, I hope the men crunk it up this morning. Amen? Amen? Did we not set the stage for the Spirit to come into the house? What do we talk about? What do we sing about? Praying. Praying is the first thing you do when you get up every morning, or you should do. You know, and that sets the poetic stage for how you should worship God. You come in love. You come in spirit and in faith. And you show conduct. I hope we're showing it today. In a couple of weeks, the women gets to do this. And maybe y'all won't be as nervous as George. But nevertheless, It's the testimony of the church is what you take everywhere you go. Everybody has a testimony. But how about the testimony of the church? How many people go, I don't know what that guy's got, but he's getting it at church. You follow what I'm saying? The testimony of the church. It's got to be there. It's got to be evidence. Well, let's get on to a little bit harsh one. Does it glorify God? How do you glorify God? What did we do this morning? What did we do? In song, amen? You know, you cannot see how to glorify God sitting at home because they cannot see how y'all are reacting to the song. A lot of smiles. And, you know, only those that come up here that sing can see. I don't know if when y'all sing, do y'all look out on the, you know. If you do, if you look at me, I'm singing with you a lot of times. Because I want to feel the same way you feel when you glorify God. It sets the stage of how I want to act for the week to come. And a lot of y'all, I know a lot of the songs you sing. And when you sing these songs, a lot of y'all sing them. When I hear it going down the road, I don't think of who's singing it. I think of who I saw singing it. And then that sets my mind to pray for that person. You ever had that happen to you? You start praying for the person you heard, you sing. I don't know why I do it, but I do it. You know, how else? Singing, preaching. How about the two young men that come up here and took up offering? That's glorifying God. You know, do you know how nervous they might have been? You know that? Oh, maybe when that's the first time Jonathan prayed over it all. It's awesome, was it not?
Yes.
That is how we are to glorify God. Let me ask you something. The only way to see if the church is glorifying God is to watch them. I'm watching you. Not yet. We ought to glorify God in everywhere we go. He called me here to hear the word of God from the man of God. Amen? Now, let me explain something. Why a lot of churches are not full of membership, because they don't like somebody. He didn't call me here to like you. He called me here to hear the word of God from the man of God. He didn't call me here because somebody else come. You see what I'm saying? So many people leave the church today because they didn't like what was said to them. Well, I guess we're going to be empty next Sunday. You cannot glorify God at home not watching it on television. I'm sorry. You cannot see how to glorify God if you're not there in the flesh. Amen? It's not the easiest thing to do, but a church must glorify God. Going on, Galatians 6:2 says this, and I'll get there quickly. I'm pretty quick at it. It says this, bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. How does a church help one another? How do you help one another? Well, through time, through talent. Well, let me give you an example, and I told you I was going to do this a lot. If Leroy wants a certain song sang before his sermon, he's not going to call this guy. Or we won't have no members left. God didn't call me to sing. He didn't call me to do that. We all have certain gifts. And a lot of people don't know the gifts or they don't understand them. But let me tell you something. I'm going to give a gift away, okay? I have never ate a bad meal yet here. Women, you got a gift. You know how to cook, amen? You know how to cook. But let me go a little bit at little farther than that. Does anyone know what the greatest gift that God gives every, I don't want to say Christian because there's a lot of them, believers unto the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you know the gift that he gives? If anybody wants to find Psalms 46 and 10, that's the greatest gift that God could ever give. You know it? It's the greatest gift. He gave every Christian, a believer unto the Lord Jesus Christ, this gift. You know what the problem is? We do not use it. We fail to use it. It says this, "Be still and know that I am God." The gift of listening. Job had that problem, didn't he? His friends didn't want to listen, did they? They already knew what the problem was. Is that not today? Is that not what people do today? I learned a long time ago, I don't remember who set the example for me, whether it was my mom or my dad or the pastor. It doesn't matter. You never say, "If it was me, I'd do this." You will not hear me say that. Because it's not me. I can only tell you what I did in that same situation. It doesn't mean it's going to work for you. It does not mean it's going to work. Lending a ear is probably one of the best things a Christian can do. Is listening. Because sometimes when people get down, they need someone to talk to. Instead, we're quick. Well, if it was me, I would quit that church. Look around. Look around. Quick. God give every one of us that great gift to listen. We don't all use it. It's in here. But we do not use it. The talents that we have and the time that we give is by far one of the greatest things that a church can do to help one another. And there's a lot of people in here that help one another. I like to be the one that helps people and nobody know about it. Because I don't need what I do drawn out because I didn't do it for me. I don't like to do that. Let's go a little farther. Bunch more to go, people. Bunch more to go. A church will be an example to all those around them. Woo! How can you be an example? Well, let me tell you something. A man once said to me at a place I used to work a long time ago, I used to build these big old trucks and stuff, and he said this. He said, "Do as I say, not as I do." That's probably one of the poorest examples you can ever imagine in the workplace today. If a man can't do it, how can he tell someone else to do it? I don't work there anymore, by the way. But let me tell you about one of the greatest examples ever given. Now, I can't tell you how old the world is today. Can anyone tell me? Oh, man, the TV will tell you all kind of answers. Just look at it. 1 million years old, 1 billion years old, 1 trillion years old, 1,000 years old. You know, you can go back as far as you want to. But there's only one example given that we ought to live by. Oh, I gave it away, didn't I? No better example than Jesus Christ, regardless how old it is. It never changed. It never changed. Without Jesus Christ, where would we be today? Lost. A dying world. And you know, to snap his finger, wouldn't nothing be here. But how does a church set an example? Well, let me give you an example of what always stayed in my mind for years, Do y'all remember when churches used to have softball teams? I don't know if y'all can remember. I lived on a mill hill, and there was churches on every corner. And this one church, every March, grew about 40 members. And that church always won the softball team. Now, the church I was going to, we I don't know if y'all know anything about softball, but you're allowed, it takes 10 players to play softball, but we only had 9. That means one short. And we had a right fielder and a left fielder, and then Doyle played center field. You follow what I'm saying? I was the runner of the team. In order to play in a church league, you had to be a member of the church. A member of the church. And before every game, you stood, and they don't do it in regular softball, but in church leagues, you had to stand on the first baseline or third baseline, depending on what dugout you was in. And normally the umpire would stand on home plate and say an opening prayer. Well, we were playing the first game of the season. We were playing that team at one every time. And the umpire finished saying the opening prayer. And then out walked a man, kind of looked like me, dressed up today. And he walked up to the ump. He said, I need to see the roster for that team right over there. That was the preacher of that church. He done had enough. Because he had 40 people going to his church for the wrong reason. He done had enough of it. And he told the umpire, he said, these guys are not members of my church. So they had to forfeit for the year. That church is still open today. Why? Because it set the example.
Now, but the pastor's gone, right?
Well, he's probably dead now. But he did. He did go on to preach a lot after that. He preached several years past that. But that church never had a softball team after that. Never had a softball team after that. What an example. What an example. Again, why do you go to church? For other reasons? You know, back in those days, and I don't know if y'all done that here, but if you missed three Sunday schools in a row, you were took off the roster. You were took off the membership. Y'all remember that? Anybody remember that? If you missed three Sunday schools in a row, well, maybe that's why the churches are empty. Who knows? I remember that, and I'm not that old. What is the example the church is leading today? What is it? It's okay to stay at home and watch it on TV? Is it? Who knows? It's the example we see in today's society. I'm almost closing. Another thing is, does it accomplish much? How can you tell what a church accomplishes? Is it by all the things it does? All these activities that churches has that's not focused around God? Is it they're so busy they don't even know who God is? I remember asking a man one time, and it ain't been that long ago. I said, what do y'all do at your church? It's a mega church. It's a mega. He said, oh, man, we do this. We do this. We got these activities. We got that. And I said, have you ever met your pastor? He goes, No, not really. That's a crying shame. When the church is so big, you don't even know who your pastor is. Because they have three services, and a different preacher or a different person preaches each one. Do you know, I wonder if that pastor knows the needs of his congregation. Maybe not. But let me give you an example of one of the greatest accomplishments that this church probably has ever seen in the history of this church. Now, there's a lot of others. I'll bring it up in a minute. COVID-19. Look at it. How many of y'all can remember before it? And look at how many people is still here. That's accomplishment. But it goes farther back than that. See, I wasn't here when the church was open. So this church wasn't here before. It started somewhere else. Am I right? And then what happened? It grew. And then they had to build a building. And then I can only tell you the accomplishments since I've been here. And I can look out on this congregation and I can tell you, and I could probably call each one of y'all's name and tell you what you've accomplished since you've been here. You know, when someone loses a loved one, they leave the church a lot of time because they blame it on God. Now, I want you to think about that, because every one of us in this church has probably lost a loved one. But we're here today. That's an accomplishment. What's it saying? It's telling us that we come for the right reason. Amen? And all right, I'm going to get to the last one. I'm going to give you a couple extra in a minute, though. If we as a church are strong, and we have a good testimony, and we help others, we set an example to those around us, and we glorify God in all things that we do, and we accomplish much. Now, you know, I mentioned at the beginning, and I'm going to mention it again. I'm going to take this just for the example. We're a little church. This is food for the thought. Okay, this is free. Last week's Sunday school lesson, it talked about God told them to go to battle, but he didn't tell them to take all of their weapons and all of that. He told them to show up. Am I right? He didn't say go to war and do all this. He said, show up, and I will take care of the battle. Now, if I was to go through the Word of God, how many battles there is in the Word of God? There's a lot. But did you know that a lot, and I'm not meaning a little, I mean a lot of these battles in this Word, God sent men home. Do you know why? Because he didn't need that many. God used little to destroy a lot. It's in here. He used little. But you know, in all of these battles that I've read and I've heard Leroy preach on, all Christ wanted them to do is show up. That's hard to do, ain't it? That's one of the hardest things in the world to do, is to show up. Uh-oh, wait a minute. I got a phone call. Hello? Well, yes, ma'am. You can join Ridgeview Baptist Church. That's not a problem. Yeah, we'd love to have you here. We do have a criteria, by the way. Yes, ma'am. You just got to show up. Hello? She must have called one of the other churches to take her. You follow what I'm saying? God said, you've got to show up. You've got to show up. How can you see how strong a church is or its testimony? How can you see how people help others? How can you see the example that the church leads? How can you tell if God is being glorified in the church? How can you see what it accomplished if you do not show up? That's what to look for in a church. That's what to look for. Now, on my way home today, I'll probably see a lot of empty churches. And churches is already closed because people didn't show up. Now, I'm going to give the last one, and then I'll close and turn it over to Leroy. But if you find a church that meets those qualifications, and I'm telling you, I can look across this congregation and say it does a lot. But if you find a church that meets those qualifications, you will find a church that is ready to meet the Lord. You will find that church. God called you here for a reason. But the question is this, and then I'll give it to Leroy. Are you ready to meet the Lord? That's the question.
You know, you ask a good question. What's the biggest church? Well, the biggest church, if you want to know the truth, is me. And any ism that you hear is not of God. So you're going to find out that it's all about me, my choices, and anything that I want to do don't interfere with. So the biggest congregation and the biggest church is a cult called meism. There was a fellow when I was in my home church. He was a member of Bogart City Methodist Church. And I was a deacon at the time. Just started seminary. And he had had a request. His request was, I want to remain a member of the Baptist Church, especially Dallas Baptist Church. Now, is it okay for me to be a member of the Methodist Church and the Baptist Church? Well, I'm not going to tell you what that answer ended up. But some of the older pastors, and when I say older pastors, but Terry's been an ordained minister a long time. My brother was, and I asked my brother when I told him about it, and he said, it's like a fellow that joined every church they was, just in case one of them was right. So a lot of times we go back and me, it's about me. It's not about but one thing, what I believe, and if I believe right and I do right, I'm going to heaven. Not so. Your salvation is based on one thing. Did you receive Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life? Have you been born again from above? Second thing is, has God truly forgiven me of my sin? Did I truly, truly ask Him to forgive me? Have I truly repented? Now, once that takes place and you're born from above, I'm not telling you you have a license to go out and sin. But I am going to tell you this. He's covered every sin from all the way through everything. Your salvation is secure because you don't have it. He does. And the second thing you must realize, will I pay for those sins that I have committed since I have been born again? Yes, you are. You'll pay for those sins. But you'll pay for them at the judgment seat of Christ. And at the judgment seat of Christ, He's going to take your rewards for those sins because you were careless. Because you truly, a lot of people then just said, okay, I'll just drift away and do as I please. And it goes right back to the heart of what the Lord is preaching. I just won't go to church. I'll watch church on television. That way I can head out of here as quick as it's over or whatever. But then you go back, and the biggest church is me. We'll find every excuse there is not to be a part of what God has planned. Now let me make sure you understand this. God the Father has chosen His bride. His bride is not going to be tainted. So if you're planning on being one of the people that make up the bride of Christ and you're careless or you don't care, or you sin and you really don't have a conviction, you're tainting the bride of Christ. And the Father has the final say-so. And if you, in any manner, mock the gift that He's going to give to His Son, who died for all of us, shed His blood for all of us, and you don't care, friend, I can't tell you where you're going. But I don't want to stand before Holy God and say, well, I wanted to live the life I wanted to. And He said, meism. So this morning, I just want to ask you, you've got to get out of the way for this church to grow. But something more important than this church growing, you've got to get out of the way that you may grow. God does not want you to stay
in one place. He wants you growing in his son. Because we're called Christians, that means little Christ. That means that he's going to choose every single person on the rapture day that imitate, act like, and follow his son. And a lot of people on the day of the rapture, whether it's a mega church, whether it's a small church, they will not empty. You can believe it, because not everybody is going to die for their sake and give it all to Jesus Christ. But with that said, I'm going to ask Joe if he'll dismiss us, but I want you to say a word of encouragement to Doyle as you leave today, and I'm grateful for the men. You did a great job. Jonathan, we enjoyed your prayer. And Sam, you did fine. George, you wasn't nervous at all. But I do not know which one that Doyle was talking about. It was beautiful back there. You or him? It was you?
Take it out.
All right. Doug, you will.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. You've allowed us to be in your house again today. Father, we pray that you would allow the message we've heard today take root in our heart, Father. And Lord, we ask that you would bless the one that brought the message today. Lord, we pray that as we go out these doors, that you would allow us to share your word. Share what we've heard today, letting people know that what they receive through a television, what they receive on a computer, isn't the same as being in your house to worship with your people. And Lord, we ask that as we go out into this world, we pray that you would allow us to glorify you, to be who you've intended us to be, Lord, and to follow your will. And Father, we ask that you would just continue to watch over us, guide us, direct us today and throughout the rest of this week. And we pray that to be your will, you'd bring us back at the next appointed time. And Lord, we give you thanks for all these things. And it's through Christ Jesus, our loving Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.